Dear friends, my name is Venkat Shivakumar. I am just putting before you in nutshell the decision of the Honorable National Compel Appellate Tribunal, New Delhi, in the matter of Bhushan Power and Steels. Tata Steel, the case is known as Tata Steel versus Liberty House Group. What are the issues in short? The resolution professional called for expression of interest. Three applications were received. One is from TISCO, other is from Jindal Steel Works, and the other is another one is from Liberty. In that, it is found that Tata Steel was the highest bidder, and later on, Jindal Steel Works, after knowing that Tata Steel is the highest bidder, they made a proposal that they are willing to pay more than that H1, and also submitted a plan saying that in case this offer is exceeded, we are willing to consider a much better offer. And then the resolution applicant, resolution professional, pursued the matter with Liberty, no response within the due date. Then Committee of Creditors considered this matter, and they took a decision. When you are able to get more money, somebody is going to offer more money, why should you reject it? Because the object of CIRP is to get maximum realizations for the creditors. So that being the objective, they in their wisdom thought that we will give option to all the people, saying that this is the second process where the H1 was submitted by TISCO. TISCO submitted a plan which gives H1. However, JSW wanted to give more. Therefore, we are again asking you to resubmit with your proposal to bring in more money. That was the issue. Thereafter, Tata Steel did not submit the revised plan, but they promised to submit it. However, they went to Supreme Court, where the decision was dismissed, their appeal was dismissed. But they, at the same time, concurrently, they also approached the NCLAT. But they were saying we will consider, but they have not given a plan. And Liberty, after the due date, they submitted another plan. So Tata Steel took that issue that H1 we have submitted and the matter is concluded. That's all. So the other claims, other actions of COC are ultra vires. This is the issue before the Honorable Tribunal. The tribunal, what is the issue that they have to be adjudicated? Now, Tata Steel has come before the appellate tribunal and asking them that we got H1. The matter is over. Again and again you are going to do, there won't be any end to this process. That is the issue. So, at what stage? Let us see the stages of this resolution process. The resolution professional will call for the applications and expression of interest. Then second step will be interested parties will make applications, and that applications will be processed and subject to the conditions of viability, feasibility, and then financial terms will be considered. Before that, whether they are in compliance with the section 29A of the Act will be checked. So the resolution professional will get the bids, and thereafter whatever the claims have come in, they will go through that. First step is you have a checklist wherein section 29A applicability, whether they are qualified, they cross that first bar. Second step is financial viability and financial feasibility, and then they will take into consideration the terms and conditions was given higher. Because if somebody gives a higher amount but they are not qualifying in these three parameters, then they will be rejected. So that is the next stage. The further stage will be the matter will be placed before Committee of Creditors, and the Committee of Creditors will be, this is a commercial decision, and it is in the interest of the Committee of Creditors, because they are the stakeholders who have given money, and they will take that decision, and then they will be voting. And if it is a decision is 66%, then that will go through. Thereafter, they will come to the adjudicating authority, and adjudicating authority will have to go through whether everything is proper, and then they finalize. Now, recently, the judgment has again come. Supreme Court said, adjudicating authority scope of questioning the decision, commercial wisdom of COC should not be given importance. So, adjudicating authority technically will go by the process, law, whether that law has been confirmed to or not. That is all the law, which is very much settled by the Honorable Supreme Court, NCLAT. So now, the next stage is adjudicating. We have discussed the stages. Now, what is the stage in which Tata Steel in relation to the application, advertisement calling for expression of interest, Tata Steel and Jindal Steel and Liberty Group have given the resolution plans. Now, the stage is when the committee of creditors are considering the bids received, and they found H1 is from Tata Steels. In the process that is yet to be put to vote, in the meantime, JSW has come into the picture offering to give them more than H1 given by TISCO. Then the committee thought, we will give option to all the three people to resubmit another plan with a better offers. So at this juncture, there is no voting has taken place, nor that been presented before the adjudicating authority. In view of this, Tata Steel has not got any vested right. Tata Steel fundamental right has not been affected. This was the contention. Whereas TISCO's contention is, once that bid is called and COC is bound to consider us because we are H1, further improvements made cannot be considered. This is the point of law before them. So the issue also is very clearly settled. The CIRP process is aimed at reviving the company, one, and the committee of creditors will have to go through a particular process. That also is discussed, and commercial wisdom of the committee of creditors, because they are the stakeholders in principle, cannot be questioned. So having said that, now what are all the, that is, whether there is a vested rights came into them or not, whether there is vested rights given to, vested rights have come to TISCO such that they can claim before NCLAT saying that our rights have been violated. Otherwise, there is nothing. That is the position of law. Now, finally, the judgment is like this. Resolution, CIRP process aims at revival of the company. There the creditors' interest is paramount, because they are the people who have lent money, and they will have to work towards getting everything as high as possible. Please note, this is not a litigation, this is not a recovery proceedings, this is not a suit proceedings. The CIRP is corporate insolvency resolution process. That is been made clear. Second point is, unless the adjudicating authority takes a stand, the rights of the people cannot be considered as defeated or confirmed, for which challenge can be made before the appellate courts. So in this case, this is too premature that Tata Steel has come before this. That is the law settled down by the Honorable Supreme Court, Honorable NCLAT. One more important thing they said is, in this point, 97.12% have come in, voted in favor of that. 2% people have not voted. But they have not directly come to vote, or indirectly through electronic media they participated. So the NCLAT came to the conclusion, you should not say 97.2% people have voted. You should say 100% of the people who have presented, deliberated, have voted. That is another important point they have taken. Third is, the NCLT has got the habit of passing adverse comments against the resolution professionals. So they said this is uncalled for comments against the resolution professional and it should be expunged. So the order is like this: RP to place Liberty resolution plan before COC in a sealed cover, unopened. Two, RP has a liberty, a resolution professional is given, liberty can be on substantial grounds. Understand, resolution plan of Liberty can be rejected only on substantial grounds and not on procedural issues, such as delay of submission or not in compliance with some internally written procedures. So on what grounds, because this person, Liberty, were late beyond that date, so that particular thing can be ignored. But so you put it in a sealed cover, take that, deliberate it, and commercial expediency should be considered. COC should take appropriate commercial decision in order to achieve the object of the code within the provisions of the code, rules and regulations. This is the judgment ratio, all that decided by the NCLAT. Now, what is the basis? And another one more point, they very clearly said you should treat the financial creditors and operational creditors without any discrimination. And in case the rights of the operational creditors going to suffer, then you must ask the concerned party to improve upon the offer so that the operational creditors will not be put into trouble. And the most important paragraphs of the judgment which I am reading out is para 31. The NCLAT relied upon the ArcelorMittal India Private Limited versus Satish Kumar Gupta and others. The Supreme Court judgment para 75 is taken up for consideration. What has now to be determined is whether any challenge can be made at the various stages of the corporate insolvency resolution process. Suppose a resolution plan is turned down at the threshold by the resolution professional under section 32. At this stage, it is it open to the concerned resolution applicant to challenge the resolution professional's rejection? It is settled law that a statute is designed to be workable and interpretation thereof should be designed to make it so workable. This is very important for all the counsels appearing to ensure that the interpretation of the insolvency code, which is in the nascent stages, you should always link the facts to the objective of the CIRP and the goal of the insolvency code, and then bring this interpretation that should make the code work. Next point is, given the timelines, this is very, very important. They are very clear in the judgment. The timelines is 180 days and extended by 90 days, so 270 days. And they also, from 23rd April 18 till date, 14 months period, which is lost because of the litigation, has also been asked to be set aside. Given the timeline referred to above, and given the fact that a resolution applicant has no vested right, that is, that his resolution plan to be considered, that is very, very important point. It is clear that no challenge can be preferred to the adjudicating authority at this stage. A writ petition and Article 226 filed before a High Court would also be turned down on the ground that no right, much less a fundamental right, is affected at this stage. This is also made clear by the first proviso to Section 30, Subsection 4, whereby a resolution professional may only invite fresh resolution plans if no other resolution plan has passed the muster. Very beautifully said. Further, para 29 of the Supreme Court decision, take the next stage under the Section 30. A resolution professional has presented the resolution plan. A resolution professional